Good morning and welcome to the 9th meeting of the Constitution, Europe, External Affairs and Culture Committee. We have received apologies this morning from Maurice Golden MSP and Mark Ruskell MSP. At 11 a.m. today, we will pause for a short act of remembrance which will take place throughout the Scottish Parliament. At this time, we will observe a 2-minute silence. Our first agenda item is our inquiry into the UK internal market, and the aim of the inquiry is to consider the implications of the UK internal market for Scotland, including how devolution will work going forward. Our first panel this morning on this topic is we will hear from Alison Douglas, Chief Executive of Alcohol Focus Scotland, David Thompson, Chief Executive of the Food and Drink Federation, and Vary Tolan, Advocacy Manager for Scottish Environment Link. Can I welcome you all to the meeting and thank you for your submissions prior to the meeting. I will move straight to questions, and I can remind members if they have wish to direct a question to a particular member of the panel, if they could see at the start. And we are constrained by time this morning, and I would ask witnesses and my fellow committee members to be succinct and where possible. If I could maybe open the questions this morning with something from all of the submissions that you gave us. It highlights the risks of the UK internal market and that governments may be more hesitant to look at innovative policies to tackle particular issues, by way of example, perhaps the deposit return scheme. And this would be in order to avoid competitive disadvantage in Scottish businesses. So the risks are that a lower regulatory standard might remain in order to retain a competitive internal market in the UK. So I just wondered what your thoughts were and how we could avoid this happening, and if I could go to Vary Tolan first, please.
Yes, hi, thank you to the committee for the invitation to appear today. Yes, as you mentioned, Convener, Scottish Environment Link has taken an interest in this issue because of the potential effect it could have on environmental standards in Scotland. I think we outlined in our submission that we think it's particularly important that we have strong common frameworks developed between all four governments involved. We see, I suppose a lot of what I've been saying today is speculative, and we don't have any case law as such. We don't quite know yet how the internal market will operate in practice. But I think what we're really clear about is that we need to see some strong common frameworks, and it's something that over the last year or so we've not received much in the way of public update about the development of those. We see the common frameworks could provide a baseline of common minimum standards, in our case particularly for the environment, that all four nations of the UK could agree to, and that would help clarify some of the uncertainty that I think there is at the moment.
Okay, thank you. Could I invite Mr. Thompson to comment on?
Of course, thank you very much for inviting us, Convener. So I represent the food and drink industry, and I guess there's a couple of things on the first is it's vitally important for Scotland's food and drink industry that we have a clear opportunity to access markets across the United Kingdom, and to some extent the Internal Market Act does provide us with that. However, you're right to point out that there are many different ways where the Internal Market Act interacts with world legislation, and really how that works and the implications for businesses, these are the really unclear points. And as we highlighted in our submission, yes, something like the deposit return system is one where, you know, we can already point out numerous complexities, and those are the kind of things that businesses will worry about in terms of how they actually comply with legislation in different parts of the UK.
Thank you. And Ms. Douglas.
Thanks very much for the opportunity to meet with the committee this morning. I think it's really clear that over the last decade and more, that Scotland's taken a much more progressive approach to improving public health than the UK government has. At the moment, we have, and we have had for a decade in Scotland, a very comprehensive alcohol strategy and commitments to make further progress, for example, on alcohol marketing. And there's an absence of a strategy on alcohol at UK level. And in that context, this legislation has the real risk of significantly constraining Scotland's opportunity to make further progress on what it continues to be profoundly damaging public health problem. These concerns are echoed by colleagues on smoking, Ash Scotland and Obesity Action Scotland. And well, I think Barry's right that in practice, the common frameworks are the key opportunity for us to try and manage and limit the impact of this legislation. Nevertheless, we do feel that it's severely curtailing the Parliament's opportunity to make progress on all three of the World Health Organization's best buys for public health, and they are increasing the price, controlling the availability and restricting the marketing of these products.
Thank you very much. I'm going to move to questions from the committee, and can I go to Mr. Cameron first?
Thank you, convener, and good morning to the panel. Thank you all for your written submissions. I think we all accept that we're at a very early stage in this process, and a lot of what is involved is finding our feet and seeing how this legislation and common frameworks plays out. That said, can I focus on the mutual recognition principle and ask you if you are able, notwithstanding a bit of uncertainty, to give any concrete examples of products, and I'm particularly focusing on alcohol products and food and drink in general, products that you are concerned about in terms of having to adhere to one set of regulatory standards within from one part of the UK and not in Scotland, as it were. Is there anything in particular that you are worried about? Can I perhaps first go to Alison, please?
Thank you. I think all alcoholic products are of concern because as things stand, there are fewer labelling requirements required on a bottle of vodka or a can of beer than there are for any other food and drink products. And that's an anomaly that is a hangover, if you like, from the EU context, where the alcoholic products were accepted from the requirements, the labelling requirements on all other food and drink. And that just is completely nonsensical. Why would you require more information on a bottle of water or a pint of milk than you would on alcoholic products, which are by their nature carcinogenic and cause a range of health harms. So that was an anomaly that we had very much hoped could be addressed, that would have been an opportunity with the UK leaving the EU, that we could make progress on that. However, as things stand, we understand the UK government is planning to consult on a limited range of measures on alcohol labelling, but it would go far short of what we would hope and expect should be on alcoholic products, including health warnings, for example.
Thank you for that. I don't know if Mr. Thompson wants to come in here.
Yes, if I could, thank you. There isn't anything, to answer your question directly, there isn't anything that we're concerned about on mutual recognition at the moment. The key question is, as legislation diverges within different parts of the UK, and in particular with the Scottish Government's commitment to continue EU regulation. And the UK Government, we really need to see what their stance is on that as they go forward. If there becomes more of a divergence in regulation, it's not about higher or lower standards, it's just in different regulation, then there is a likelihood that if that became an issue where it wouldn't allow goods to be placed on the market, for example, in England, then that would be of significant concern to the Scottish food industry, and vice versa, of course.
Thank you. I don't know if Vari Tollan wants to come in here on mutual recognition.
Yes, thank you. I think one of the products that we would want to highlight from the environment sector is peat compost used in horticulture. It's something that the environmental NGOs have been campaigning for a long time for a ban on the use of peat compost, and we need that to protect our peatlands, which are a vital carbon store and sink, and it's crucial to our efforts to reduce Scotland's climate emissions. I think there's proposals in the programme for government to consult on a ban on peat compost in Scotland, but this is something where, say, if peat compost was allowed from suppliers in other parts of the UK, that it could become difficult in practice to limit its use in Scotland, given the principle of mutual recognition. So that's something that we've highlighted as a concern.
On peat in particular, interested in this issue, am I right in saying that the UK government has also committed to a ban from 2024? Is that your understanding?
Yes. I think we just would like to see action taken, you know, as soon as we can.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Can I bring Ms. Boyack in? Thanks.
Thanks very much, Convener, and welcome to the panel. Thanks very much for the evidence you've given us in advance. It's been really interesting working our way through it. Can I follow up the questions that Donald was just asking there about different impacts across the UK? And first of all, come to Vari Tollan, just to follow up that issue about that peat discussion. It's really at the forefront, I think, given that we're in the middle of COP26, or towards the end of COP26 now. That issue about your submission says that the UK Internal Market Act could pose challenges for Scotland's ambition to implement a ban on the sale of peat for horticulture in this parliamentary session. You've just said that you think this may or may not be the case, but can I ask what interaction you've had with both the Scottish and the UK governments about that particular policy issue, and to what extent have you been able to talk to parliamentarians in both parliaments as well to even start that conversation?
So that is something that certainly we've noted as an issue in terms of engaging with the UK government. That's something that we work with partners across the UK on, so particularly the Greener UK network based in London. It's not an issue that we've had direct correspondence with the Scottish Government about, but it's certainly something that is on our radar, that we would be concerned of any potential chilling effect that this legislation could pose. And I think the Scottish Government has intended to consult on this issue this year, so that's something that, you know, we would raise our concerns there in that forum.
Thanks. And can you give us examples of other environmental challenges? You've talked about EU standards, that we're actually trying to ramp up environmental standards and going forward. Can you give us examples of other kinds of products where we've got a position in Scotland where we're trying to meet environmental standards, which could be for nature reasons or it could be for net zero reasons, where the UK Internal Market Act could cut right across that? What are the things you're particularly concerned about?
Yeah, so I think the deposit return scheme has already been mentioned, but it would also affect any efforts to limit the use of single-use plastic items, so perhaps something like takeaway containers for food and drinks or anything that kind of falls under that bracket of disposable plastics. We've seen Scotland already take a step ahead on banning plastic cotton buds, it's actions like that where I think we would be concerned that there could be a limiting effect given the UK market regulation. I think as well we've got some other concerns. It's probably not directly products, but you know, there's areas where Scotland has gone above and beyond to protect, for example, certain wildlife species such as red squirrel. And maybe come back to this later, but that's something where under the EU, Scotland was able to, and the UK was able to take that extra step to give extra protections to red squirrels, but not necessarily in other EU countries. And so we have concerns that perhaps going above and beyond in examples like that, again, might be limited. That's probably more relevant to the non-discrimination principle, so I'll maybe expand on that later.
Okay, thanks. And to pick up but move sideways, can I ask both the other representatives, Alison Douglas and David Thompson, about the challenge that you've both highlighted in terms of alcohol issues and the sale of products. There's a very striking statistic in the evidence about alcohol-specific death rates, 68% higher for men and 78% higher for women in Scotland compared with England and Wales. So it's obviously a big issue about responsible alcohol drinking. Can I ask both of you about the discussions you've had with both governments? Because there are certain products made in Scotland which are part of our core economy, but there's also something about responsible drinking. So it's that discussion about getting the balance right. And I would be interested in hearing maybe first from David Thompson about, again, what discussions you've had with both governments on the basis that this public health is a devolved issue, and what engagement have you had with both governments about that issue? Because, you know, there's a debate in Scotland, but quite a strong ambition to address this issue.
Yeah, so I'm going to have to take the fifth on that. So we are the Food and Drink Federation, but we don't actually represent alcoholic drinks at all.
Okay.
If it's helpful, I can talk about public health more widely, and in particular obesity regulation, if that would help. If not, I will pass over to Alison.
No, please do. Thank you.
Can I apologise on that? I was misreading the evidence.
But please come in, Mr. Thompson. I think that's all relevant to where we're going.
Okay, that's fine. Yeah. So we have a very small number of alcohol, but none actually in Scotland at the moment. So we haven't really been engaged in that dialogue. On wider kind of public health and nutrition angle, then we do know there are bans on advertising being proposed and implemented in England, and the Scottish Government had its own previous regulation put forward, then postponed because of COVID, but actually we know that that's intended to come back, but was mentioned in the programme for government this year. So the we do have dialogue with both the UK government and Scottish government, Food Standards Scotland and the Food Standards Agency, about this and a whole range of different things, because we are, you know, I've already given evidence on a number of common frameworks as well. It's clear, I think, that there, you know, the civil servants themselves are still trying to work through what the implications are, and they're very keen, I think, to make sure that there isn't, as you said at the very start, convener, there isn't a disadvantage, a competitive disadvantage for Scottish businesses when selling into other markets. So apologies for any confusion.
Sorry, it's probably my fault. I think I was looking at the comments you've made about a deposit return scheme, and I was putting both you as witnesses together on the issue of drinks and making assumptions there about what kinds of drinks. Could I get a comment from Alison Douglas about that point I made at the start as well, about different policies in different parts of the UK and the tensions for implementation?
Yeah, absolutely. So I think the whole of the UK has a significant alcohol problem. Scotland's, as you say, is a bit more acute than England and Wales. However, you know, the Welsh Assembly Government have also considered that minimum unit price is an appropriate and proportionate response to the scale of the alcohol problem which they're facing. The Northern Ireland Assembly are also actively looking at minimum unit pricing. But then that's a very clear example of where Scotland, because of the the chronic and acute nature of our problem with alcohol led the way on minimum unit pricing, and that was in part a kind of creative response to the fact that we didn't have other economic levers such as alcohol duty at our disposal. But it's actually ended up that in scrutinising and identifying that mechanism, what the Scottish Government realised was that the policy actually had a more targeted effect on the people who suffer the greatest harm from alcohol. So that's an example of where the flexibility to bring forward a different policy in Scotland has been a significant advantage, and we've seen that policy deliver a reduction in consumption of 3.5%, and in the first year of operation, a 10% reduction in alcohol-specific deaths. So it would be a profound loss if we're unable to both improve that policy. The Scottish Government's talked about the problems, potential problems of uprating minimum unit price because of the Internal Market Act, but also we all know that price on its own isn't going to turn the tide of alcohol harm, and that we need to do other things. Scottish Government's committed to consulting on alcohol marketing, for example, as part of the within the next year. So that's very much something that we would support, and that we would hope that the Scottish Parliament could make significant progress on, because of the clear evidence that particularly when it comes to children and young people, that influences when they start to drink, how much they drink, and whether in later life they go on to develop an alcohol problem.
Thank you. Ms. Mintel.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you to the panel for submitting your submissions, I suppose. I'd like to follow on vein of questioning. I think, as you've just said, Alison, that devolution has given nation-specific organisations an easier link into the decision-making process and policy shaping, and specific to the needs of each of our nations. So I'm interested to hear really from all of you as to how you think this legislation will impact on your ability to do that. So perhaps if I come to Vari first, please. Also, actually, Vari, I'm interested as well, you described at one point in your submission a race to the bottom, so if you could expand on that too, please.
Yes, of course, and thank you. Yeah. I suppose for the race to the bottom, what we're concerned about is that given that the market access principles set this new common baseline, that if one part of the UK was to decide to lower its standards, and currently we don't have, there's nothing to prevent that from happening, that it would perhaps put other nations in a position where they feel they also have to lower their standards in order to maintain a competitive disadvantage. And I think I was saying earlier that that's why we might come to it later on, but common frameworks we would see as being a mechanism which could provide a common baseline across the UK for, particularly in our case, environmental standards, where there's minimum standards agreed to, and that would be a kind of backstop preventing this race to the bottom. It's something that we are concerned about. It could be, for example, I mentioned red squirrels in answer to Ms. Boyack's question earlier, but if, for example, some protections on particular species were perhaps to be lowered to allow for development or other activities could take place, it could cause issues in other parts of the UK.
Okay, thank you. And with regard to how you think you'll be able to influence specific policies that Scotland, its differences require?
Yes. So in terms of influencing, I mean, I think this makes it all much more difficult. It adds a layer of complexity onto everything. We would certainly still look to raise issues with MSPs in the Parliament and with the Scottish Government, where we feel the internal market is perhaps causing problems or if there's technical issues that need to be overcome. But I think for us at the moment, it's unclear exactly how that engagement will happen with stakeholders. And we would like to see more clarity from the governments about how exactly any disputes will be resolved in practice. Okay. At the moment, that's not clear.
Okay, thanks. Thanks, Barry. And Alison?
Thank you. Well, I think we have some experience in Scotland of the use of litigation to deter and delay the implementation of progressive public health measures, most conspicuously in relation to minimum unit price, which created a 5-year delay in the policy. And in our view, because of inflation during that period and since, we've seen the erosion of the impact of that policy in practice. So, you know, internationally, it's well established that the use of litigation is a common tool for industry trying to protect their interests. But not more than that, it's the fear of litigation or the risk of exposing yourself to litigation that can cause this chilling effect that we've talked about. And so, you know, there's a huge opportunity cost for an administration in defending a case. So while we were going through that 5-year process with the various courts, there was action that we would have liked to have seen to complement minimum unit price action around marketing, labelling, controlling the availability of alcohol, all of which simply had to be put on hold because of that ongoing legal process. So I think we really shouldn't underestimate the effect of this, and Scottish Government have, as I say, talked about the potential risks around minimum unit price, and that's despite the fact that minimum unit price was explicitly raised during the passage of this bill in Westminster, and the UK government saying it wouldn't apply to minimum unit price. That still seems to be a moot question, both amongst academics and with Scottish Government. So I think that's a real concern. Also, people have raised the issue about the common frameworks and the transparency and the ability of, you know, civil society organisations, voluntary sector to scrutinise and input into that process. So that would be a major concern for us. And clearly, we've got limited capacity. You know, we operate in Scotland. Most of what we're trying to influence is here in Scotland. And like Environment Link, we would be collaborating with colleagues at the UK level to try and influence UK government. But that is an overhead for us. That's really kind of beyond what we can do in practice. So I think all of that kind of limits our ability to be part of the process and part of the decision making.
Thank you, Alison, for that. And Dave Thompson, similar question to you as well. How do you think your organisation will have to shift to be able to contribute to policy that's being questioned from a UK-wide perspective too?
Yeah, so I'm in the lucky position as compared to Barry and Alison that FDF Scotland is part of the FDF at UK level, so we have the ability to advocate for the industry at the UK level. We've also got a sister organisation, FDF Cymru, so in Wales we can do that as well. And we work very closely with our colleagues of the Northern Ireland Food and Drink Association, of which we, our submission is part of. So we do have the ability to advocate for the industry in different settings. I think it's not really going to change what we're going to do, because the Scottish Government is still going to set standards and approaches that will be different than Wales and England and in Northern Ireland. So for us, I don't see that changing an enormous amount, and it kind of depends, I think, on what the reaction is by the governments across the UK on how they work together on common frameworks, which they've done on labelling, which they're going to do. They're working together on extended producer responsibility and a range of things, or whether they want to plough their own furrow, which is currently what's happening on promotions on public health and promotion restrictions. So we think we're still going to have to be alive in all these different arenas talking about that, and we think that there will still be differing outcomes.
Thank you, David. Can I just one supplementary to you? Vari in her evidence talked about the race to the bottom. Do you have any concerns that Scotland's high quality food and drink may get caught up in something similar?
In food and drink, there is no evidence of a race to the bottom at all. In fact, it's probably a race to higher standards. Is the opportunity even. And it's really important to understand, I think, from a food and drink perspective, that the customer, whether that's a supermarket or the food supplier, they put in place incredibly high standards, and businesses match those. And certainly there's no appetite from consumers across the UK for lower standards at all. So I can understand where people are raising these concerns, but in terms of food and drink, I don't see that, and there's certainly no evidence of that to date.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Dr. Allen?
Question for Mr. Douglas, please. In your written evidence, you say very directly the Act undermines the ability of devolved legislatures to legislate to protect public health. I'm interested in what you say there, and I think there'll be a lot of people in the devolved legislatures who would share that concern. But can I ask if you could maybe just elaborate for those who maybe don't know what the Act is or what it does, why you have that concern in terms of how you feel it might restrict future legislation?
So I think, and you'll forgive me because I'm not a lawyer, so you know my understanding of exactly how things operate or how they will operate in future is not a legal one, but I have kind of talked to lawyers about it. So my understanding is that it may not actually proscribe the Scottish Parliament from legislating, but it would be severely limited in the practical effect of that legislation. And so the net effect of that is to significantly undermine the impact of and the intended impact of the legislation. So that if the Scottish Parliament legislated, for example, on alcohol labelling, because that wouldn't apply to any products that originated from any other part of the UK, or indeed any other products that were imported through another part of the UK, the only organisations to which it would apply would be Scottish-based organisations. Now, I don't have figures on what proportion of the total sales that would impact, but it will be a small percentage. So I guess it's about this kind of, you know, deterrent effect of why would you legislate if the only products to which it would apply would be a very narrow set of products. And therefore, you wouldn't be able to have the policy effect, and all that you would be doing would be disadvantage Scottish-based companies. So from that point of view, it curtails the ability of the Scottish Parliament to make meaningful change and progress on protecting public health and indeed the environment, etc.
Thank you. And you've mentioned some of the potential areas of new legislation around alcohol that it could affect. I don't want to try and ask you to speak for other areas of the organisations representing health, but do you feel that there are other areas in areas of public health where the same concerns are being or might be expressed?
Absolutely, Ms. Minto's question was about, you know, our ability to to participate in and put the case in Scotland and at UK level for progress on public health. And you know, our colleagues in ASH Scotland and Obesity Action Scotland very much share our concerns, but all of us are struggling both to understand the potential impacts and to participate in the process. And you know, that is also true in relation to the common frameworks, which are, you know, really opaque at the moment, but also, you know, there are three different common frameworks that would apply to labelling, for example. That's extremely challenging as, you know, a third sector organisation to engage with. And, you know, I noted in the material which the committee has before it, there are estimates of the number of common frameworks that range from about 21 to 33. You know, so we don't even have accurate information on how many there are, what stage they're at. Last UK government information came out in May of this year, so presumably things have changed significantly since then, but we don't know. So absolutely our concerns are shared by other parts of the public health third sector.
I was also interested in something that you said about how you felt, if don't want to put words in your mouth, but I think what you said was that if these changes implied the need to try and influence action at Westminster more than you would have to do at present, then that would, I think, did you say that would present a resource issue or a challenge, or that would be more difficult to do than it is to try and influence Holyrood?
Absolutely, and you know, I think the, you know, in terms of lobbying, you know, clearly private sector organisations have considerably greater resources than the third sector has. We have neither, as things stand, the expertise nor the capacity to significantly engage at Westminster.
Thank you. I think similar concerns were expressed 300 years ago. They're written on the side of the Parliament about nobody's nails can reach the length of London. I wonder if Vary would be able to comment briefly on something that the Crofton Federation said in their written evidence, where they talked about how they didn't feel, I'm going to read this out, sorry, while they accept the need for an organised market, this must be designed and agreed by all four UK administrations, not imposed by one. Vary, I think you... Ms. Tolan, you touched on some of these issues, but do you feel that either legislatures or organisations such as your own have been involved in the design of the proposals around the single market?
I would agree with a lot of what Alison has just said, that, you know, we're also limited with capacity and our expertise to engage with the UK government, so I would say that it is difficult for us to be part of those conversations to influence. We've done what we can and responded to consultations when they have, when the opportunity has been presented. But yes, it is much more difficult. I think we certainly would want to see common frameworks agreed collaboratively with all four governments across the UK. I think that is, you know, the best way to ensure that they can be effective if they're agreed jointly. And that indeed is what the intention that's been set out is, for them to be agreed jointly. But I think also, as Alison said, it's pretty opaque at the moment for us about what is actually taking place. And we would very much like to see more information coming forth from both the UK and the Scottish governments about what actually has been taking place over recent months on the development of common frameworks.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Ms. Boyack.
Convener, just a quick supplementary to David Thompson. It's just a question about, you talked about different standards in different parts of the UK impacting negatively on producers. And I wanted to just go towards the end of your submission, where you've talked about if one UK nation increased or lowered product standards in their own jurisdiction, there might be areas where enhanced protection might in principle be desired. Do you want to say what you meant by that?
Well, yes. I mean, our job is to make sure that we are working for and on behalf of the food industry, which wants high standards, and it wants those standards not to be undermined. So you know, philosophically, there might be a situation where one part of the UK legislates in a way that the food and drink industry thinks is detrimental to our business model and reputation across, and this is across the whole of the UK, not just in. And in those kind of cases, then you might easily make the argument that undermines the progress and the good reputation of our great food and drink industry. So that's, in that kind of situation, you might say, well, actually, is there something that we can do to provide that protection to the rest of the UK's food and drink industry, whether that's in England, Scotland, Wales or Northern Ireland?
Sorry, what would that mean? What do you mean by enhanced protection?
Well, I think it would mean that in a way that perhaps the Internal Market Act or the Common Frameworks don't, but in particular the Internal Market Act don't allow, it would mean that there might be things that, you know, we would make the argument that we might want to carve out of the Internal Market Act because of the one legislature undermining the standards that we're.
Okay, and to draw the parallel, you've also talked about a trade without the UK. So, for example, there have been concerns raised about potentially new UK trade deals with other parts of the world that would have lower environmental standards. How would that impact on UK products? You've talked about worries about standards changing within the UK, but what about imports from the rest of the world that potentially were lower? What about the impact on products being produced here? Are you concerned about that?
Yes, absolutely, and I think that's widely held across the food and drink industry. There's a significant concern at the moment because the UK hasn't yet put in place the import controls and restrictions in the Trade and Cooperation Agreement. So that's one element of concern. You know, in some ways that helps because we can import packaging and raw materials that we need to produce food here. But in the other side, then UK products that's produced here. Is already not competing on an even playing field with imported product. So that's part one. Part two is if a trade deal is done with a country that has lower standards and that impacts on domestic production, then if that can be imported into any part of the UK and then passed across the whole of the UK, then yes, there is a specific concern that might, for example, undermine the high production standards we have in Scotland and in other parts of the UK.
Thank you.
Thank you. I wonder if I could ask a supplementary, and it's maybe mainly for Alison Douglas. We've talked a lot about new innovations that we might want to introduce post-Brexit and under the new common frameworks. However, You also did mention that you were concerned about the erosion of impact of some of the existing innovations. And if we take minimum unit pricing as an example, the previous Kenneth Armstrong, who was the advisor to the previous committee, did highlight in a briefing paper that the modification of that, such as changing the price to make it in line with inflation, will not be dealt with under the EU laws as were and the legislation as was. It will be now come into the new frameworks. And do you fear that could open up further litigation against the policy and we could end up with actually, you know, policies such as minute unit pricing, some of the smoking legislation and these areas actually going backwards from the position that we have now?
Absolutely, that's a very real fear that we have under the Internal Market Act. If existing legislation is substantially amended, then it could fall within the scope of the Act. And there's no definition of what substantially amended means. It could indeed mean uprating minimum unit pricing. And obviously, the policy becomes less effective over time as inflation erodes its impact. So when the policy was first introduced, or indeed when it was first agreed by the Parliament, covered, I think I'm right in saying, 64% of all alcohol sold in Scotland. By the time of implementation, so because of that five-year delay, that had reduced to 50%. And if we look at the comparator for England, Wales today, it would be 34%. So then you can see that the kind of the scope and impact of the policy has profoundly changed since 2012. So we are very much pressing for the Scottish Government to review the price, as it has undertaken to do within 2 years. That hasn't happened due to COVID, but we're saying that in order both to make good inflation, but also to increase the impact, now that we know the policy has positive benefits without any significant unintended consequences, that really we should be looking to increase the impact, save more lives, and increase the minimum price to 65 pence per unit. But we just don't know, and we have this uncertainty over whether the Scottish Parliament could deliver that because of the Internal Market Act.
Thank you. I don't think there's any further questions from the committee this morning. Can I thank you all, Ms. Douglas, Ms. Thompson, Mr. Thompson and Ms. Tolan, for your contributions this morning. And I'll now suspend briefly while we change over the witness panel. Thank you. And welcome back. Our second panel today will also give evidence in the UK internal market. The committee will hear from Michael Clancy, Director, Law Reform, the Law Society of Scotland, and Jess Sargent, Senior Researcher at the Institute for Government. Can I welcome you both to the meeting? And again, we're going to move straight to questions from our committee this morning. And if I can open with a sort of general question about the impact of the UK internal market agreeing to UK common frameworks on the Scottish Government's commitment to align with EU law. And could I maybe start with Ms. Sargent on that one? Thank you.
Absolutely. Obviously, common frameworks were originally designed without the UK Internal Market Act. That came later, and there's a question as to what implications that will have for their progress in being agreed. So far, it looks like that isn't an impediment, although there is outstanding disagreement at exactly how the UKIM Act, the common frameworks will treat the UK Internal Market Act. In terms of how that interacts with the Scottish Government's plan to keep pace with EU law, I think one of the challenges will be if the UK government takes action to take advantage, as it would argue, of its post-Brexit freedoms, to take action to make businesses more competitive compared to kind of EU regulation. If the Scottish government keeps pace with EU law in some of these areas, then it will only be Scottish producers that are required to comply with these new requirements. any kind of goods imported, particularly from England, if we think about here where the UK government is acting for England only, will not have to continue to comply with the Scottish government's regulations, which are replicating EU law, which could put them at a competitive advantage, and therefore Scottish producers at a competitive disadvantage.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Clancy?
Good morning, convener, and thank you very much for that question. So, of course, common frameworks, although they were thought about before the UK Internal Market Act came into effect, or perhaps even was a glint in the draft person's eye, were at the basis of common frameworks was the concept of the internal market. In October 2017, when the Joint Ministerial Committee agreed the principles for common frameworks, one was to establish them where they are necessary in order to enable the functioning of the UK internal market while acknowledging policy divergence. And I think they have been generally considered to be a success in terms of intergovernmental working between the UK and the devolved administrations. Is perhaps shown by the recent report which was issued by the UK government on progress in terms of common frameworks just on the 9th of November, where it was indicated there that up to 32 common frameworks had been agreed, and that there were essentially three which were outstanding in terms of things like carbon capture and one or two others. So I think that aspect of common frameworks is part of the concept of the UK internal market, and as such is being operated quite a responsible and respectful way by the various parties to those common frameworks. I think it's also significant that a large number of common frameworks have been brought together without any hint of legislation, but simply on the basis of agreement between the governments. And that, I think we could all agree, is a good sign. The impact on continuity, we indicated in our paper, which we submitted to the committee in advance of this session, that EU law is proceeding no matter what. As you saw there in the table, which my colleague Adam Marks produced, there are 1,356 basic adopted acts which have taken place over the course of last year, and 734 amendments to existing legislation. So there is an enormous amount of EU law which is being made, whilst we are not actually considering them. And you'll have seen also, because I know I still have to finalise the comments which we're going to make on the Scottish Government statement policy in connection with the Continuity Act, that at the moment the Scottish Government has not taken any action to align with EU law. How does that fit with the UK Internal Market Act? Well, we don't know, because nothing has happened to trigger those provisions. But we do know that amendments to existing legislation will be captured by the two principles of mutual recognition and non-discrimination. And so when considering alignment with EU law, the Scottish Government will have to take into account very carefully the extent to which any changes which will be made will be captured by the UK Internal Market Act. I think that's probably enough to give any Scottish minister a moment to think about what they want to align with and how they do that.
Okay. Our previous panel were from Alcohol Focus Scotland, Food and Drink Federation and Scottish Environment Link. And one of the concerns that they raised in their submissions was about dispute resolution. Do you think within the context of the frameworks that dispute resolution, it's clear to businesses how this will take place in the future or where the challenges are likely to be against. Will it be against the common frameworks? Will it be against the legislation itself? Have you, are you able to comment on that at the moment? I'll go to Mr. Clancy first.
What an interesting question. If we're thinking about dispute resolution processes within the context of intergovernmental relations, then the existing memorandum of understanding between the UK government and the devolved administrations is quite difficult to see how that would satisfy very many people on the outside. A dispute has to be, first of all, considered by civil servants. Civil servants take to ministers the idea to resolve the dispute, but ultimately it's a political decision by ministers as to whether or not the dispute is resolved. And that, I think, tells us something about the problems of the current structure. But as you know, Convener, the whole process of intergovernmental relations has been under review and new provisions are still being finalised, I think. But certainly there are moves towards greater formality in connection with intergovernmental disputes. We need to wait until those are properly finalised and published before we can actually make an assessment of them. But it will have to require elements of trust, which do not apparently seem to be present at the moment in this connection, and also elements of independence, which I think all administrations concerned are well aware of the types of views which we've expressed. Lord Dunlop made some comments about this in his report, which he did at the instance of David Cameron when he was Prime Minister. But that report, I think, has not landed with the current UK government in the way in which it perhaps had been hoped at an earlier stage. And so we need to see exactly what the final shape is, and that's a matter for the governments to agree.
Can I just ask if Ms. Sargent wants to comment on that? Thanks.
Yeah, absolutely. So as Michael said, there's kind of two elements to this. There's the political element, and I think one of the challenges about dispute resolution there is that we haven't seen a lot of the common frameworks, so we don't know what the dispute resolution is there. We also know that in the ones that we have seen, the kind of final stage is escalation to the kind of overarching intergovernmental mechanism. So that's currently through things like the Joint Ministerial Council. We know that the four governments are working together on this review. We've seen a kind of progress report on that, which suggests that there will be this improved dispute resolution procedure. But because that still doesn't have agreement, that hasn't been implemented. So there's questions there at the political level. I think for individual businesses, particularly when it comes to how the UK Internal Market Act will be applied, there's still a lot of uncertainty, because rather than preventing regulations that contravene the terms of the UK Internal Market Act from getting on the statute books, what it says is that those regulations will not be applied to, you know, businesses that they shouldn't be applied to. So, for example, if the Scottish Government passed a law banning chlorinated chicken, but it was permitted in England, the law would still say that chlorinated chicken is banned, but if something was imported from England, then it just wouldn't be applied to that product. Now, there's a question of who's responsible for determining whether or not these regulations should be applied and to which products. It might be, you know, as lower level as kind of local councils and their kind of food standards teams, who may have to make these fairly politically contentious decisions that might have quite significant implications for businesses. But again, it's not clear how those businesses might be able to challenge decisions that they believe are made wrongly, whether these will end up in court or whether there'll be some sort of other process. We won't really know how that works until it's tested, but I think there's still a lot that's quite unclear.
Thank you. I'm going to move to questions to the committee, and Dr. Allen, can I go to first?
Thank you very much. Mr. Clancy, you've given a picture of how perhaps the considerations that have to go through the minds of a minister or others in the Parliament before legislating are more complicated than they were when the Parliament was first re-established. Of course, one of the other considerations in all this is Northern Ireland and the Northern Ireland Protocol. Can I ask if either of you, in fact, can say a bit more about the considerations that come into play when Scotland acts?
Well, I'm unmuted, so therefore it's me. Thanks very much. Well, of course, the Northern Ireland Protocol is in a bit of flux at the moment, as we've seen, as the negotiations between the UK and the EU continue to try to refine. I think the word renegotiate is probably prohibited. Refine the terms of its application. What one can say in terms of the law relating to the Northern Ireland Protocol is that there is quite a bit of law in the Internal Market Act relating to it. Part 5 of the Act deals with the protocol. Section 46 of that Act requires an appropriate authority, which includes Ministers of the Crown and Scottish Ministers and the other devolved administrations, to have special regard for the need to maintain Northern Ireland's integral place in the UK internal market. Now, that place is, of course, to be within the customs territory of the United Kingdom and to facilitate the flow of goods between the Great Britain and Northern Ireland. This is mirrored... sorry, a beep on my computer. This is mirrored in the Northern Ireland Protocol, which in Article 6 also seeks to protect the internal market, the UK internal market. Section 47 of the Act guarantees unfettered access to the UK internal market for Northern Ireland goods, subject to the somewhat minor NIGB checks, which are found in the protocol. On goods transferring from the Great Britain to Northern Ireland, however, the principle of unfettered access is slightly modified, the market access principles would apply subject to the extensive restrictions and processes in the protocol. So we have to wait to see what the outcome of the discussions are between the UK and the EU, and there might be changes which will be made. I don't know if that's enough at the moment, Mr. Allen, but you'll be able to say if you want some more.
No, I think that's very helpful.
I wondered if Jess is eagerly awaiting the opportunity to speak.
I was just going to suggest the same.
Miss Sargent.
Sorry, I can't seem to hear the session anymore, but I'm assuming that's my cue to come in. great. So the Northern Ireland Protocol, as Michael was saying, and the UK Internal Market Act have asymmetric effects. So while Northern Ireland produced goods, provided they are considered qualifying goods, can be sold in Scotland without meeting any additional regulatory requirements and without the need for any checks and paperwork. Currently, as it stands, as the protocol is written, and as Michael said, there is still some discussions going on about the exact nature of how that will work in future, but currently, Scottish goods to be sold on the Northern Ireland market will have to both comply with EU law and also be subject to certain checks and paperwork. Now, I think one of the things that Scottish ministers will need to bear in mind in future is the potential for divergence between Scotland and Northern Ireland and the effects that that might have on the UK internal market. Essentially, it means that going forward, if Scottish producers want to be able to sell in both the Scottish market and the Northern Ireland market, they'll need to comply with both the EU regime and the Scottish regime. Now, at the moment, that's not a particular problem because the law is quite closely aligned. And actually, as we know, with the Scottish, the powers that the Scottish ministers have taken in the continuity bill means that actually it's likely that there will be continued alignment. Therefore, these problems are likely to be mitigated on the kind of Scotland NI dimension, though there are concerns about what it might mean for goods going from England, for example, to Northern Ireland, where there might be more divergence. But it's certainly something that Scottish ministers will need to bear in mind, because if the costs of trying to comply with these two different regulatory regimes become too high, then we might see producers in Great Britain pulling out of Northern Ireland, which is likely to kind of exacerbate some of the problems that we've already seen around trade flowing freely within the UK internal market.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Ms. Boyack.
Thanks, Convener. Thanks to you both for your excellent submissions in front of us today. It's been very helpful. Can I kick off by asking Michael Clancy a bit of comment from you about the question we asked about scrutiny, transparency and accountability challenges, and how we as a parliament, or how we as a parliamentary committee engage in that. You've explained just the sheer number of potential changes that may take place in terms of legislative change. Can I ask you about the issue of the capacity of third sector or business organisations to give their views and what the process is? It came up in the last session that it's really difficult for third sector organisations to be able to cope with the sheer scale of change that may be taking place. But it's an issue for us as parliamentarians, because the way the Parliament is structured is to enable us to get views from third sector organisations, and the issue of timing. So are there things that you think could be done to actually improve scrutiny of how we take evidence, given the time constraints and just the sheer complexity? What would be your top issues? And it's interparliamentary work or intergovernment work. Are those issues that you'd be top of your agenda?
Thank you very much indeed for that question, Ms. Boyack. I suppose the problem is that issue that the UK Internal Market Act is a UK Act, and it is embedded in the legislation that there could be impacts across the UK by virtue of changes to legislation, because the Act is predicated on market access from any part of the UK to any other part of the UK for goods and services. So this is a very broad vista of change. So therefore, I think, as we said in our submission, the Parliament would have to consider the resources which would be necessary to devote scrutiny to the legislation which could come from the UK Parliament, from the Senate of Cymru, from the Northern Ireland Assembly, and, of course, legislation which is homegrown in Scotland. Could also be exacerbated if individuals or businesses take court action in connection with any legislation which is affected by the Act, and the decisions of courts, which could be any court in the UK, might be in the position to begin the process of interpreting the Act and interpreting the way that legislation is going, and being applied. So I think that's the first question, is how does the Parliament deal with this large vista of legislation? Almost every committee in the Parliament might be engaged in having to deal with issues which are actually part of the Internal Market Act question. And so therefore, it's not simply this committee, which we're sitting around the table on at the moment, but also the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee, the Economy and Fair Work, Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice, Finance, and public administration, and other committees in Parliament could find Internal Market Acts issues in their inbox at any time in the future. And so therefore, looking at resources of the Parliament overall to begin to think about dealing with these matters is something which is very important. I think also it is a question which has to be addressed to the Scottish Government as to what resources they are actually putting into this whole process, and what do they intend to do? What is the plan in terms of dealing with matters when, let's say, for example, a regulation is changed in Wales, which has an impact on some food aspect in Scotland, perhaps something relating to hill farming or agricultural produce in Scotland, which we hold dear, and how that then begins to affect the economic, social and legal framework which surrounds that kind of matter. In the legacy report, of course, you all have that as part of your bedtime reading every night, I'm sure. The overall approach to the scrutiny of policy development in those areas which were previously within EU competence is a significant factor. The extent to which the government can provide the Parliament and its committees with regular updates on developments in EU law, and that takes us back to that other inquiry which you have embarked upon about the Scottish presence in Europe and how the Scottish Parliament and the Scottish Government become aware of and can act on information which they and intelligence which they receive from Europe. Then the appropriate and proportionate level of scrutiny for the operation of the future relationship with the EU. So these are all significant matters. You ask about joint parliamentary working. That is obviously something which would be clearly very helpful for the Parliament to embark upon. I recollect in prior to Brexit, Lord McFall's parliamentary forum, which was, I think, welcomed by all the parliaments involved. And I think that under the TCA, of course, there is due to be a UK parliamentary delegation to the joint EU-UK parliamentary forum. And I think that it is unfortunate that the devolved legislatures are not included in that. And I reference the letter which was sent recently on this matter. That doesn't prevent us from thinking about re-engineering something domestically which would enable all the legislatures to get the best information on an up-to-date basis. Same applies in the intra-governmental sphere, but we've already discussed some of the issues around that.
Thanks, that's very useful. I'm particularly interested in the both the parliamentary and the joint ministerial work. And there's obviously a tension about transparency in terms of governments talking together, but there hasn't been a JMC for 3 years now, but it's not been replaced by something else. So that's clearly something to think about. So thanks for your evidence on that. Can I ask Jess Sargent about, there's a comment both she made and the Food and Drink Association made about local officials being able to interact on this issue about food standards, for example, and it's something you raised in your previous answer about local authorities at council level being able to come up with decisions on food standards. Can you just say a little bit more about that? Food and Drink Association regarded it as disruptive. So that's possible at a local level, even though decisions are being made at a UK governmental level about food and drink standards, and you mentioned chlorinated chicken. Is that technically possible? Because we've been assuming that that might not be.
Yeah, I think one of the challenges with kind of administering the UK Internal Market Act is just how many actors are involved. It requires not just discussions between the UK government and the devolved administrations, but as you say there, UK government and local councils. There's also a role for the courts, perhaps, in some of these areas where there are disputes over the interpretation or the application of the Act. And it's not clear to me that there is necessarily anyone in the centre, particularly the UK government, that is thinking about all these various aspects and trying to kind of to tie them together. So I think that that is a real challenge, kind of making sure that you have all the people who are affected by this kind of in one room, and you're able to consult them all when all these various decisions are made, and you can have lots of different processes put in place, for example, for the UK government to talk to their local government, for the Scottish government to talk to their local government, and for the UK government and the Scottish government to talk to each other, but it's not really clear exactly kind of how they all join up, essentially. I mean, I just wanted to pick up on some of the points you made about kind of interparliamentary working and kind of JMC structure, because it's something that we highlighted in a report we published in June on the UK internal market. I think one of the key things about intergovernmental working is that because the different governments are negotiating with each other, they have less latitude to negotiate with their own legislatures or with civil society groups and things like that. I think the best way to try and address that is for all the legislatures and civil society groups to try and put pressure on that intergovernmental agreement, on that process, to put pressure on their respective governments. And I think that's the best chance of actually getting change there. As you say, the JMC committee structure still hasn't been replaced. There were some proposals set out to establish more interministerial groups, which would be ministers from different departments coming together to discuss issues relevant to their policy area. I think some of those are starting to be implemented, even though that kind of formal IGR review hasn't been concluded. So one of the things we recommend that I think could be really helpful is establishing kind of committee chair levels between all of the four different parliaments to scrutinise that interministerial group. And I think that's one of the suggestions. Michael also mentioned the precedent set there by the Interparliamentary Forum on Brexit, which I think could also be a very interesting thing to explore and something that we recommend. I think one of the main barriers to that at the moment is the lack of interest, really, in the UK internal market and common frameworks, particularly amongst MPs in the House of Commons. There is some work on it in the House of Lords. So I think there's a question there about political appetite, but it's something I certainly think will be very important, and there should be more thinking on.
Thanks. I think that's something that would be really interesting to pick up. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you. Mr. Cameron?
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to our panellists, and thank you for your submissions. Can I stick with intergovernmental relations? Because it strikes me that this is absolutely fundamental. And I just suppose just my question is hopefully a simple one, but what do each of you see should be the key elements of a new intergovernmental system? I think you've mentioned trust and formality, but I just would like to get a kind of basic synopsis from you of what you think we need. And if I could start with Michael Clancy.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr. Cameron. The issue, of course, is that we are working with currently an intergovernmental system which was designed through the Memorandum of Understanding and the various devolution guidance notes many years ago. And like all of these things, it needs revision. And that process has been going on. It has not yet completed, but it is in the process of being modernised. It will only work if all the parties agree, and it will only work in practice if the parties can create an atmosphere of trust which does not appear on the face of it to be present at the moment. Except in that single exception of common frameworks, where there seems to be very good intergovernmental working, especially at official level, but also at the ministerial level too, when it comes to minister. So trust is one thing. I think clarity about what the structure is another. And towards the end of the question which Ms. Boyack asked there and her reflections, she mentioned about confidentiality. And of course, confidentiality is one of those features which limits the transparency of the arrangements. And I reference in our paper the revised UK Government Central Collection webpage, which includes the issues about joint review of intergovernmental relations, which was published in March of this year. And in that paper, intergovernmental relations are, we are told, in paragraph 7, best facilitated by effective sharing of information and respecting confidentiality of the content of the discussions. But of course, that tension which is created between confidentiality of the discussions and transparency of the decision-making process is a difficult circle to square. And that, I think, is part of the problem, because the communiques from the joint ministerial committees are, by and large, not very communicative. They might be just a list of the people there and the broad topic which was discussed, but not all, and some which delve into technical matters in relation to phytosanitary issues or agriculture matters, something like that, can be quite detailed. And I think if we were able to get to the point where there was much more light shone on these discussions, then that transparency would assist some of the trust building and mean that all of us on the outside would be able to judge what exactly any problems might be within the room and perhaps be able to make representations about that.
Ms. Sargent.
Thanks. Again, at a minimum, I would say it's really important that interministerial machinery is functional. And I think at this point, it's not fully functional. And I think that is the priority, is to create a new system that works. I think COVID showed the problems that could be created when you don't have those ready-made machinery to go to that works. We saw initially a reliance on UK government kind of forums and meetings through COBRA and the interministerial groups. But I think the main thing that we really need in the reform structure is machinery that facilitates engagement that reflects the devolution settlement, that where the four governments are coming together to discuss matters that are devolved and which they have equal powers over, and in some senses the UK government speaks only for England, that the way in which these forums are constructed reflects that. And I think some of what we've seen in the progress report on the intergovernmental review does reflect that. We've seen things like a rotating chair, a shared secretariat. I think we're actually getting quite a lot closer to something that is more suitable for the devolution settlements. There obviously are still some disagreements as to what happens in areas where matters are reserved and, you know, are legitimately a matter for the UK government. I think it's really important that there is still very good communication with the devolved administrations in those areas, particularly where it has implications for their devolved areas, but you might want a slightly different kind of arrangement there. But I think the priority at this stage really is to conclude the IGR review and put these mechanisms in place to make sure that there is good intergovernmental working. I think various matters that we've discussed today, both in this session and the session before, really highlight the importance of making sure there is good intergovernmental working. And at the end of the day, common frameworks don't cover all policy areas. Even if they are working well, there are many other policy areas in which we need good intergovernmental coordination and we need structures to facilitate that.
Thank you for that. Can I ask Jess Sargent a question about, I think, something she said at the very start of this session to a question from the convener, when I think you said that the UK Internal Market Act was not an impediment to the development of common frameworks. Clearly, we're in, you know, it's the early years of the UK Internal Market Act, but could you just expand on what you meant by that, please?
Absolutely. I think when the UK Internal Market Act was first introduced, there was a question as to how that would play into some of the politics and whether that could essentially halt progress on agreeing common frameworks. I think we've seen that hasn't happened. We're still waiting for the final frameworks, but we are hearing that there is good progress being made on them, and we are going to get to that point. Now, there is still a question as to how it interacts with common frameworks. I've argued in the paper that we published in June that common frameworks should be the primary mechanism through which discussions of divergence happen, that the UK Internal Market Act, and I think we have to accept the reality that is now on the statute books, but that is some sort of kind of backstop in the event that we can't reach agreement through through common frameworks and through intergovernmental agreement, because I think that is really important. I mean, the other thing to mention also is the amendment that was made to the UK Internal Market Act in the House of Lords, which allows new exclusions to be added to the market access principles on the basis of an agreement in common frameworks. This could allow the four governments to agree that in some circumstances, divergence is completely acceptable and absolutely fine, and you don't need the UK Internal Market Act, you don't need the market access principles to apply. Now, we highlighted that is a potential source of disagreement if you don't have a shared understanding of when and how that power should be used. But as I and we recommended that there should be a very clear process put in place to make sure that any proposals for new exclusions are considered on the basis of their merit, on, you know, the economic impacts, on the policy benefits that they could bring. And as I understand it, there are ongoing discussions between the four governments to try and agree that sort of process. So I think that is a really positive development.
Thank you. I was very struck by the passage in the Institute for Government report, which dealt with the issue of policy divergence, and I think very fairly said that, you know, it has its pros and cons. You know, it allows policy divergence has allowed parts of the United Kingdom to pursue entirely different policies around public health. You mentioned smoking, for example, but on the other hand, it can also lead to trade barriers and sort of lack of competitiveness amongst other parts of the UK. And I suppose my question is, how do we strike the right balance here? Do you think that the system of common frameworks, which I think is where you end up, is the right way of doing this?
Yeah, I think that is the question, really. And I think there is an argument that the UK Internal Market Act, as it's written, with very few exclusions for things like environmental objectives or public health, doesn't quite strike the right balance here. I think it's something that we should be continually monitoring and thinking about and assessing. We know that the Office for the Internal Market is going to assess the economic impact of future regulatory divergence and the operation of the common frameworks and the UK Internal Market Act itself. But it's not clear who's going to assess the policy impact. And I think that's really important here. I think actually committees like yourselves have a really important role to play to collect evidence from various groups and various sources to understand what policy impact this is having. Obviously, the four governments will also kind of conduct their own assessment. Like I said, I think the answer to some extent is common frameworks, because I think a lot of this will have to be done on a sort of case-by-case basis now. We'll have to see how it's working. If it's clear that there is, you know, a certain area of public health legislation, like, for example, alcohol regulation, that is continually coming up against the problem of not being able to be effective because of the terms of the UK Internal Market Act, then I think there might be a really strong case to inclusion exclusion there. So I think really common frameworks are a good mechanism to continue these discussions about the introduction of common frameworks in the UK Internal Market Act. As I said before, they don't cover all areas covered by the UK Internal Market Act, so there are going to need to be discussions and intergovernmental discussions outside of those. But I think this is very much a living beast, and I think all four governments should be, and particularly the UK government, should be open to tweaking things, to changing things, to letting them develop as we get more and more evidence about how this is actually working in practice.
Thank you. Ms. Mintle.
Thank you,
Convener. Ms Sargent, thank you very much for that response, which I hope my question asks for a wee bit more in that line. You will have listened to some of the evidence that we got from the previous panel, specifically around alcohol minimum unit pricing. And one of the submissions from Alcohol Focus Scotland commented directly that UKEMA may prevent the Scottish Government fulfilling its legal obligation of putting health before profit. So I was wondering if you could comment slightly further on that. And also you touched on the environment there as well. So I'd be interested to know what your thoughts, your comments with regards to lower regulatory standards in order to remain competitive within the TERSET, within the internal market bill.
Absolutely. I mean, one of the things I learned throughout the course of my research on the UK internal market and on our report is that it's very difficult to distinguish how it will apply in these kind of slightly more hypothetical cases. I think there certainly are risks here, particularly around, you know, single-use plastics was an example given earlier, and I think that's one of the most clear-cut examples because it clearly bans something which, you know, in, for example, Scotland, that could continue to be sold if it was coming from elsewhere. I think other cases aren't as straightforward. I think there is a question about minimum alcohol pricing, and it seems to come under the non-discrimination principle, which not only has kind of several caveats in which you have to prove both an adverse market effect, and also it's not a way of pursuing a legitimate aim. But also, at the end of the day, all that requires is that regulation isn't discriminatory. It's not quite as kind of harsh in its application as mutual recognition. So I think we don't really know exactly how cases will play out until they really are tested. I think it's right to raise these concerns. And perhaps I sound a bit like a broken record, but I think the best way to address them is through kind of intergovernmental working, particularly in the environmental space. We do know that all four governments do have a commitment to raise intergovernmental standards, and that actually a lot could be done if they all agree to jointly raise standards. I mean, there was an example I was looking at recently about adding folic acid to bread. So that was something that was initially proposed by the Scottish Government. They were particularly interested in doing that. They asked the Food Standards Scotland to get an assessment of it. Their assessment was that actually this would be not a very effective policy if implemented on a Scotland-only basis, and recommended that something UK-wide should be considered. Then the Scottish and Welsh governments wrote to the UK government, not saying this process is all easy. There was obviously a lot of discussion and a lot of back and forth. But at the end of the day, they were allowed to agree things on a kind of UK-wide basis. And even despite the kind of political challenges of working on governments and different strikes, particularly in the environmental space, we know that the most effective policies have to be implemented on a wider scale. You know, that's the reason for COP in Glasgow this week. I think it is an area in which I hope that good intergovernmental working could mitigate some of the risks that have been identified about the potential aspect of the UK Internal Market Act. But I think it is something that, as I said in my previous answer, we should keep an eye on, and if we are seeing that the UK Internal Market Act, because intergovernmental working isn't happening as we might like, is a regular impediment to the devolved administrations implementing ambitious environmental or public health policies, then I think the UK government should seriously consider adding an exclusion to prevent that effect.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Clancy, have you got anything to add?
I think I agree it's quite difficult at the moment to construct scenarios which are anything other than speculative, but in our paper we highlighted the one which Professor Nicola McEwen had identified as being one of her Centre on Constitutional Change blogs about the Scottish Parliament passed a law to prevent obesity, and such a law might require producers to reduce the sugar content of food or drink, or have bolder labelling on recommended daily intakes. Now, what the market access rules essentially say, both the mutual recognition and the non-discrimination rules, is that a law passed by the Scottish Parliament is not necessarily unlawful. In fact, it doesn't touch on the validity of that law at all. It is a perfectly valid law. The issue is when there is an importation into Scotland of a product which does not comply with that law, but complies with the law at its point of origin. And that is the problem, is that act of importation from another part of the UK, or from something which has been imported into another part of the UK. That is when the issue will become real. That then creates all of those questions which have been circulating around the table this morning from the very beginning in the earlier session, as well as this about what are the implications of two, on the face of it, perfectly valid products complying with the law which applies to them being in circulation in the market in Scotland. And that's something which reaches into the economics of the issues, the competition. We've heard of talk about the race to the bottom in terms of standards as well. There might be, in fact, I'm sure there is, because it's something which many of our food and drink producers, not just exclusively them, but let's pick that as an example, vaunt very highly are the high standards to which Scottish produce is produced, and that of itself is a reason to buy the product in the face of cheaper but inferiorly standard products from elsewhere. And so, therefore, it's not a clear-cut picture, but until we actually have that real example, it's going to be a lot more speculative than I would like.
Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Clancy, my apologies. You wanted to come in on a previous point that Mr. Cameron had been asking. Do you want to do that now, please?
Unfortunately, Convener, I think the moment has passed.
Okay. Well, Mr. Cameron's got some more questions, so maybe not. Bring Donald in. Thanks.
Sorry. I was going to ask you about the Sewell Convention, which you mentioned in the Law Society submission. And I think it's fair to say that this has come under a lot of strain in recent years. We've seen the UK government legislating without consent, and we've seen the Scottish government refusing consent, if I could put that as neutrally as possible. And you say in your submission that no inference should be drawn that the Sewell Convention has been diluted. Can I just ask you to expand on the convention as a tool or as a method of intergovernmental, interparliamentary working, and what you see its future being?
The Sewell Convention, rather the Legislative Consent Convention, let's not dwell too much on one person who's been involved in it. It has quite a long pedigree. It was used in Northern Ireland during the time of the Northern Ireland Parliament from 1921 until 1971. It featured in colonial administration and a recent, in inverted commas, case related to the Parliament of Southern Rhodesia in 1963, the case of Madzin Bambuto v. Ladner Burke. So it's something with a pedigree. And what it says, as you know, I think, but let's put it on the record, is because it's declared in Section 28 of the Scotland Act 1998 that the UK Parliament will not legislate on devolved matters without the consent of the Scottish Parliament, not normally legislate. And normally is the issue which has occurred most frequently in over the past few years. Looking at the legislation which has been passed without the consent of the Scottish Parliament or betimes the Welsh Assembly or the Senedd Cymru now, we have, of course, the important Brexit legislation and also the UK Internal Market Act. And I think, can we view these as instances where normality is suspended because of their importance to the UK as a political entity? And I suppose that what we were trying to assert in that statement about the importance of the Legislative Consent Convention not being diluted is that it still applies and it is declared in statute. There is case law which interprets it. The Miller one case was one such case where the Supreme Court was able to say that there aren't any legal consequences of not complying with the convention, but there may be political consequences. And that is what being a convention essentially means, that there might be political consequences, parliamentary consequences, but there's no legal consequence to not complying with the convention. So I think it's about that kind of recognition that it still applies. It still applies to lots of legislation which goes through the UK Parliament and which affects matters which are within the devolved sphere in Scotland and which are quite normal in their discussions between the governments prior to introduction and in the way in which they pass. But these contentious issues, nationally, UK nationally contentious issues, such as the Brexit legislation and the UK Internal Market Act, are obviously ones which would attract the not normally provision be the basis upon which the UK government would proceed to enact to have the legislation enacted then to put it into force. So I think that's where we are getting to, is that in the ordinary course of events the convention works still. But there will be exceptions to the ordinary course of events, and hopefully those will not be too many in the future. Having been present when the convention was declared in July 1998, I was in the advisers' box, the opposition advisers' box in the House of Lords when Lord Sewell stepped up to the dispatch box to make it known that this was how they were going to deal with this issue. Then I can tell you that for most of its existence, the Scotland Act and the other devolution legislation has existed perfectly happily on the basis of the convention, and it is only in these particularly contentious matters that it has not functioned the way that people expected it to.
Thank you. Can you bring Ms. Boyack?
Thank you very much, Convener. It's a question to Michael Clancy about the references you make in your submission to the domestic advisory groups and the Civil Society Forum. Now, this wasn't something I'd been aware of before, but I note that there was an advert middle of October for inviting people to put forward their interest if they wanted to be a member of this. Can you say a little bit more about this? This wasn't something I was aware of before, but it's clearly an attempt to try and broaden out involvement by third sector organisations, by trade unions, to enable them to have some sort of say in this process, but it's not something that's had a lot of public awareness, I think it's fair to say. And you've talked about an annual meeting would not actually be appropriate, it needs to be a bit more regular. Mm-hmm. Could you say something about the potential opportunities that come from this and to what extent it's got a relevance in Scotland? Is this primarily UK established? It talks about The advert says that it will rotate between all four nations of the United Kingdom. It's not something I was aware of before, but is this something that's kind of just under the radar for us and will be significant? Thank you.
You know, I'm genuinely surprised. I thought you read the TCA, the Trade and Cooperation Agreement, from cover to cover all the time, Ms. Black. So I'm really surprised at that. But it is one of those provisions which only anoraks up until now have had something to say about. Before you accuse me of being an anorak, I'll freely admit to having come across this before. So the Trade and Cooperation Agreement contains a number of institutional structures to try to make it, from its lofty position, regulating the relationship between the UK and the EU, something more concrete for the people who will actually be affected by the processes and decisions made by, say, for example, the Partnership Council and others. And one of those features is the parliamentary assembly relationship, which we've spoken about earlier. And then there are these ones which drill down to more local aspects. So we welcomed the participation of civil society provisions in Article 12 of the TCA and in Article 13, which talks about domestic advisory groups, and in Article 14, which talks about the civil society forum, which reflects the suggestion that the Law Society had made with regard to the architectural structure of the withdrawal agreement in 2018. So Article 12 says that the parties, that's the UK and the EU, shall consult civil society on the implementation of the TCA and supplementing agreements. So that's the one on atomic energy and one or two other things, in particular through the interaction of these two types of groups, the domestic advisory and the civil society forum. The Article 13 tells us that each party should consult newly created or existing domestic advisory groups comprising a representation of independent civil society organisation on issues covered in the TCA. In particular, the focus was on non-governmental organisations, businesses and employers' organisations, as well as trade unions those who are active in economic, sustainable development, social, human rights, environmental and other matters. A very broad sweep of civic society. And in much the same way as in the early days of the Parliament, there was the Scottish Civic Society Forum, I think this is an attempt to make sure there is more than the governmental voice at the table. And it's something that we have suggested that we agree with, and we support the idea that there should be such a forum, that the domestic advisory groups should be ones which are established and function well. We talked about the idea that there should be room for people representing the legal professions in the UK to be a party to this, because of the issues arising out of the TCA and the maintenance of the rule of law and the administration of justice. And we think that these are key to the functioning of the TCA. We also thought that the kind of bodies which are involved in this should be broad-based, should not just include what some people might refer to as the usual suspects, but should be centred on the communities which ultimately the treaty should be able to serve.
Thanks very much. I'm quite keen that that is part of our scrutiny as well going forward, to the extent to which that group operates and is relevant to us. Thanks, Convener, and thanks, Mr. Clancy.
Thank you. I've got a few final questions. I'm afraid not quite finished. It was just obviously, you know, we have a specific role in this committee, but other subject committees of the Parliament will also have the ability to scrutinise in certain areas. From the discussion we've had about the Interparliamentary Forum on Brexit, just to let you know, I think we've dropped the Brexit from that, but we will be meeting on the 10th of December. And it was just to ask, obviously that was an informal arrangement that came about from different legislatures to work together. And I'm just wondering if you feel that there needs to be a more formal position for those kind of fora at the moment, like the Interparliamentary Forum, and whether or not you think that guidance on transparency and guidance on scrutiny, particularly for select committees across different areas, it needs to be more formalised going forward. I'll go to Mr. Clancy first.
The TCA convener ensures that there is formality between the European Parliament and the national legislature, which is the UK Parliament. I think that if it is good enough for the TCA to create such an institutional structure for parliamentary interchange, then we have to ask for something similar, because the devolved legislatures are not included in that. And this was a point which we raised as soon as we saw the TCA and as soon as we made representations to Parliament in terms of the European Union Future Relationship Bill way back between the 26th of December last year and the 29th of December, in advance of the debates which were taking place in Parliament just before the end of the year. So having something which brings the devolved legislatures together and the UK Parliament is a way of informing those members of the UK Parliament who are going to be sitting at the table with their EU counterparts on this inter-parliamentary group. I know that the EU has identified its 30 members already, and the process for identifying the membership from the UK Parliament is working its way through at the moment. Now is the time, the auspicious time, for the devolved legislatures and those people in the UK Parliament who want to progress such an idea to get together and be able to transmit ideas from their constituents to the UK members of the intra-parliamentary group under the TCA so that we all manage to have some kind of a voice at that table.
So obviously there's a government relationship there, but also there's the relationship of the parliaments. And do you think, I maybe picked up wrong, I thought you thought that the PPA structure had been confirmed in the UK. Do you think it's still possible that there might be delegates on the PPA that include people from the devolved legislatures at this stage?
No, I don't think so, convener, because the TCA is quite specific about the nature of the parliamentary the UK EU parliamentary group. It does not include devolved legislatures. I think the phrase used, I don't have it in front of me, is the national parliament or the parties, and of course they are to establish this, which is to I'd be surprised if there's room to include devolved legislature members at this point, because I don't think that that works with the TCA. But what I think does work is for the legislatures to discuss amongst themselves and with the UK Parliament a way in which there can be another stratum here, which can bring together the legislatures, broad legislatures, and the UK Parliament in a way which then informs the views of the UK Parliament members of the group.
Okay, thank you. Can I bring in Ms Sargent if she wants to comment on those? Yes.
Absolutely. I'm very pleased to hear that the Interparliamentary Forum, no longer on Brexit, but Interparliamentary Forum no less, is meeting next month. I think that's a really great development. In terms of the question you made about formalising structures, I mean, I think there are obvious benefits to it in that it means that these sorts of discussions aren't reliant on kind of political interest from certain members that might at any point kind of change or ebb away, and they can ensure that this happens kind of consistently and systematically. I think the one concern I would maybe have is about participation from all of the parties in the Northern Ireland Assembly. And by formalising structures, I think there is a risk that could become a bit more difficult. I think that's easier in an informal structure. Having said that, I would hope it was something that wouldn't be insurmountable, but it might need to be treated sensitively, and something perhaps there could be further discussions on.
Okay, thank you. A very quick question on the frameworks, because you said that quite confidently that they have developed and they're being delivered, and we won't really understand the working until further down the line. But does it concern you that what we're hearing from other areas of from the economy, from Civic Scotland, is that they don't feel they've been included in that, and they don't feel that there's transparency in how these have come about? And whose responsibility is it to inform the wider civic society in the UK about the frameworks and what impact they will have? I'll go to Ms Sargent first, and then to Mr Clancy.
Yeah, absolutely. I think it is incredibly hard to try and scrutinise common frameworks when you don't know what they look like. And I think the nature of what they've ended up is slightly different to perhaps what particularly a lot of civil society groups were expecting at the beginning. I think this is in part a factor of the fact that these are, at times, have been quite political discussions. I think one of the big barriers to reaching agreement and publishing the frameworks recently has been some of the sensitivities around the Northern Ireland Protocol. And I think that's meant that groups that perhaps could have been included have been shut out of the process because of those sensitivities. Obviously, once it's we're waiting for the process to be published, but obviously that won't be tested until you actually have an instance of policy divergence to test it. And I think that is the point at which civil society's views will be most relevant. And I think where civil society groups will be most of value in order to kind of put their views to the four governments. And really, I think it's important that they're able to feed into the process when these discussions are still ongoing and not when a decision has been made at the end, because once a decision has been made, it's very unlikely the four governments are going to want to go back and reopen that. So I think there's a question of how this fits with the scrutiny process, particularly in the relevant devolved legislatures, because I think that is a really good way for civil society groups to be able to feed in. I think there's a question of what the trigger mechanism is for that scrutiny, because like I say, if it comes at the end, once a policy is all kind of tied up in a bow and an intergovernmental agreement is reached, then I think there's little chance that will make a huge amount of difference. We know that some of the frameworks have review processes inbuilt, so it's possible that could be a point at which there's a bit more transparency about what is being discussed, and therefore you could take evidence from kind of various interested groups. But I think that's still a bit of an open question and an area that needs a lot more development.
Okay, Mr. Clancy, do you want to comment on that?
Yeah, if I could just... I am sure that transparency over the negotiation of frameworks is yet another issue of a bit of difficulty because some of these things are extremely technical. Indeed, when the original list of 111 points was issued by the Cabinet Office a few years ago now, I undertook a piece of work to try to get my head around what this meant, and we produced a paper on the 111 points, tracking them through their European legal origins, primarily, to where we were at the point at which they were listed in the 111 list. That, of course, then became 150, and I think at its height was 163 items, or areas of the law, which were subject to this process.
I'm going to have to interrupt. We're going to have to go to a 2-minute silence. I do have another question, so if you could stay with us, but we will be pausing for a 2-minute silence, and I ask members to stand if they're able. Thank you. One for observing our Remembrance Day. 2-minute silence. Mr. Clancy, I return to you? Sorry.
I know that time is precious, so I'll be quick. I think the important thing is that all of these areas had a basis in European law, which had gone through the relevant processes in. Whichever legislature had been responsible for implementing them. We know what the baseline is for many for all of the common frameworks arrangements. What we don't know is how the common frameworks ethos, in terms of those conditions which I mentioned at the start of the meeting, which were decided on the 17th of October, all apply to them. What we can say is that as they progress through their process, and the report which was issued on the 9th of November is an example of the element of transparency which is brought to this, they get scrutiny in the legislatures. And I can point to the hazardous substances planning framework, which was finalised and implemented in the last reporting period, which is had scrutiny in all four legislatures. So I think it is a point at which can one affect this common framework. Probably it would have to be something very dramatic to affect the common framework if someone came up and said and made representations to the appropriate committee dealing with it. This framework is flawed in some kind of a way. It would have to, I suppose, be quite dramatic, something which all the others who had considered this missed in what are very technical areas, such as the law relating to radioactive substances, certain aspects of company law, agricultural support, etc. So I think, yes, there ought to be an opportunity for civic society, those who have a particular interest in a common framework, be able to make representations. That probably is, in its most proper form, the Parliament in Scotland, because it is the Parliament which probably, some of these are quite elderly, probably implemented the original EU directive or regulation which made the basis for the common framework necessary in the first place.
Thank you. My final question is around, and it's a bit hypothetical. Much of what we've talked about today has been hypothetical, but in an ideal world, the frameworks will work perfectly and there will never be a need for executive power to be exercised by the Westminster government. Now, my understanding of the Scottish Parliament committees is that we are, under the Scotland Act, empowered to scrutinise the Scottish government. But what actually happens and how can that scrutiny take place if there's an executive power at Westminster used in a devolved area? How would we, as a parliament and a number of committees, look at that? And whether that might mean a change to something like the devolution guidance along the lines? And just if I could get your comments on that. And I'll go to Ms Sargent first and then to Mr Clancy.
Thank you. Yeah, absolutely. There is a question. I presume you're referring here to the kind of some of the powers in the UK Internal Market Act itself for the Secretary of State. Is that right? Yeah. Yeah. I think there is a question as to how they are scrutinised by the devolved legislatures, because they could change the terms of the Act quite significantly. Actually, I mean, I think there is likely circumstances in which they would be used would be to add new exclusions. Which would hopefully be to create, kind of make the Act more permissive rather than make it more restrictive. But there is a possibility that they could be used to make it more restrictive. The power for the Scottish Minister to the UK government has to seek consent of the devolved ministers, but if that's not forthcoming within a month, they can just proceed anyway. So there is a risk here that it could be used in a way that was perhaps improper, essentially. I think there is certainly a question as to how that relates back to the Scottish Parliament. I think you're right. I think there is a unresolved issue as to how and whether something like the Stoole Convention should apply to secondary legislation. I think we saw a good mechanism to allow that through the EU Withdrawal Act, but it might be that going forward, we see things like this more frequently. So rather than just kind of considering things on a case-by-case, act-by-act basis, perhaps a kind of broader convention that applied to secondary legislation as well as primary legislation would be most appropriate. I mean, there's obviously opportunities for the committee to do sort of informal scrutiny, even if it's not kind of required by any specific process. So, for example, if it looks like this power has been used to take evidence from certainly the Scottish Minister on their position on that power being used, and potentially also the UK Minister, obviously, that there's nothing the Scottish Parliament can do to compel a UK Minister to appear before it. But we have seen increasingly UK Ministers appear before the Scottish Parliament. So I think that's something that we recommended. Now the lines of Responsibility and accountability have been blurred slightly because actions taken by the UK government will have implications for the exercise of devolved powers. I think that is something that should happen more regularly, and perhaps there needs to be a commitment here for the UK government ministers to be ready to appear before Scottish Parliament committees, Welsh Parliament committees in the Northern Ireland Assembly to justify when and why they have used these powers.
Mr. Clancy.
Thank you, Convener. As Jess Sargent mentioned there, the provisions of the UK Internal Market Act, where the Secretary of State can seek the consent of the devolved administrations, devolved parliaments, when making certain exclusions from the market access principles under Section 10 or services exclusions under Section 18. There's a process there for waiting for that consent, and if it's not forthcoming, proceeding to make the order in any event. But that, of course, is not the equivalent of a legislative consent motion for subordinate legislation. As you quite rightly point out, the devolution guidance notes, it's quite clear that the legislative consent convention does not apply to subordinate legislation. It only applies to primary legislation. And that's an important feature which has been there since the very beginning of devolution and the creation of the Parliament. So how does that work then in terms of any future changes? A revision of the devolution guidance notes is part of that issue which revolves around the intergovernmental process, which we've been talking about periodically this morning. I have not heard anyone say that this would be an issue which is on the table. So therefore, how does one affect UK ministerial action or Scottish ministerial action in terms of making regulations? Well, one hopes that the relevant minister would consult on the making of some subordinate legislation which you might be concerned about. It's one of the sort of standard amendments which we promote when dealing with bills in the UK Parliament, is that ministers should consult with appropriate persons before making regulation. The fashion which we've seen in terms of coronavirus legislation for made affirmative regulations to be produced is something which cuts across any kind of debate or discussion in these sort of instances. And we've seen, and I'm sure you will be aware of, instances where regulations have been made on the 11th of November at 5 p.m. Precisely, without there being any significant debate in Parliament, and it is a take it or leave it situation. Take it, there is no leaving it, it becomes the law. And so therefore, this then begins to be a bigger issue about the whole nature of delegated legislation, the resources which are applied to scrutinise that legislation. And I'm sure if you went and asked the members of the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee if they are satisfied on the whole with the nature of consultation on delegated legislation, etc., they would probably have a number of criticisms about that. And it is the same in Westminster. The Hansard Society has recently published further thoughts on making delegated powers more habile to scrutiny. Just the other day, they published their report on that, something which I might recommend the committee read. It's on my reading list for later this week. I think it's important for us to understand that this is not a problem related to the Internal Market Act. it is symptomatic of a wider issue about the scrutiny of ministerial lawmaking power, the power which the Parliament lends to ministers in the acts which it passed.
Okay, thank you very much. And can I thank you both for your attendance at committee this morning. I'll now close the public part of today's proceedings. Thanks.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you very much indeed. Bye-bye.